midweek service, and I think we pretty much took care of all the announcements. Those of you that are going to prison on Friday night, make sure you're touching base with your leader, and that is Brother Eric. So thanks to all of you that have been a part of that and helped to make that happen. So it's a sacrifice to take time off and to go do these things. But I tell you what, folks, we're here more than just to eat, breathe, live, work, and sleep. We're here for more than that. And I think God's calling us to be an inspiration of hope and vision to this generation that we live in. Pastor Joe talked about the dark time that we're living in, and yeah, I can second that. I don't think there's ever been a time where, anyway, in my lifetime, that it seemed like this world was in such division and just uproar, and everybody's so sensitive. And but it really, it seems like the spirits and the hearts of men are just waiting for their button to be touched. And I'm here to say that we got to be better than that. And God's people, we're going to have to rise above the darkness and the ashes and take the light of Christ that's within us and be that vessel of inspiration and hope in this dark hour that we live in. Because I believe that the light has come to God's people for those who want it. And I believe that God's not only doing a work in our midst, but in churches all across this nation, and bringing God's people to a realization of the fact that, you know, we're living in troubled times, and we better start getting a hold of God, and we better start banding together. Because I'll tell you what, folks, God's still on the throne. He's still in control, and I appreciate that. Every day I can go into the Word of God, and it still says that He holds this earth in the palm of His hand. It still says every day that He rides upon the clouds as a chariot, and or the clouds are the dust of His feet, and all these scriptures about who God is and what He does. That doesn't change because the circumstances of this world are in a turmoil around you. And I believe this is the message of hope and faith, that you and I have the opportunity and the privilege and the calling to bring to a generation that many don't know which is up and which is down anymore. But I tell you what, the world is looking for a voice of stability. It's interesting, John the Baptist came in the midst of a very volatile time, 400 years, if I understand history correctly, that it was 400 years Israel was without a prophet. And 400 years that the Bible doesn't really account, from the book of Malachi to the book of Matthew, other than we know it was probably a pretty troubled and shaken time. But it's amazing that John the Baptist came. It was a message of rebuke to many, but you know, it was truth. And if I read the Bible correctly, multitudes came out to hear this man preach the word of truth. And I believe there was more than just truth and rebuke to the words that he was speaking, but he was speaking something that was filled with life. It was a new voice. It was a fresh voice crying in the wilderness. God's people are looking for a shepherd. And that employee that you're working with day by day, side by side, rubbing shoulders with, that crew of people that you're dealing with day in and day out, as most of us are, we're working around people and we're living everyday lives, they need to see somebody that's stable. They need to see men and women that have purpose in life. They need to see men and women that are unshaken by difficult circumstances and challenges that are most certainly to come. How many of you have been here long enough to know that life doesn't always deal you a fair hand of cards, does it? Sometimes it seems like it's stacked against you. But the Bible is full of men and women that came out of those adverse circumstances, and they chose, not only because of the benediction of God that was on them, but they chose to be somebody different in the middle of a vulnerable, sensitive generation. And I know Brother Hogan made a statement a long time ago, and I'll never forget it. And he said, this world is no more sinful and modern to us than it seemed like it was to the apostles in the book of Acts. And I said, you know, that is an interesting perspective. And we know that the Bible says where sin abounds, grace does much more abound. If this world is so full of sin and wickedness and unrighteousness, do we as God's people really understand what God has given us?
That's right.
We really need to think about the promises of God and the power of God that He has placed inside of this book. And if you and I are thirsty and we're hungry enough, we can tap into that living water. And it's as fresh or more fresh today than it was 2,000 years ago. It's the same living stream that the Lord Jesus Christ Himself dipped into and gave to a dying generation around it. This is who we need to be. And so tonight, with that in mind, I'm going to talk about a vessel of inspiration. I've spoken about this before. I guess you could say I have similar notes or close to the same notes, but anytime you preach a message two, three, four, five times, some evangelists have been known to have three, four messages, and they preach them hundreds of times across the nation, and it's always a little different. And so as a pastor, as a preacher, I never apologize for preaching something twice, because I need to hear it, and most often everybody else needs to hear it. And we need to be reminded of why we're here. So, I seen this quote the other day, and it was one of those quotes that was riveted into my spirit when I heard the man speak it. And I've been pondering on it ever since. And the gentleman made the statement. He said, when we quit fighting for what we want in life, the things that we don't want will ultimately overtake us. And we know that there's a fight of faith. And the devil is not a respecter of persons. Just because you're going through a difficult time, that doesn't give him the signal to let you alone. And so these are things that we need to be reminded of, that if we're going to tap into what God really wants us to tap into in our life, there's going to be a fight involved. And to be filled as a vessel of hope and inspiration, it never comes on the flowery beds of ease. But how many of you have been here long enough to figure out that through circumstances in life and through experience and things that happen to us, if we choose not to get bitter, not to point the finger, not to ask the why question, if we choose not to go down that road, these negative circumstances that ultimately are designed to derail us and knock us down and beat us up and leave us whimpering forever, those same circumstances, if we take them through the lens of faith and hope and relying upon God, those things can be building blocks for you and I to ascend into greatness with our God. And so anyway, this is how we want to look at tough times in life. Everybody has a tougher story than someone else. It seems in mainstream, the world around you today, everybody's always trying to maybe kind of outdo each other on who has the toughest life. You ever been in that kind of a conversation? Why did this happen to me? Well, you know, the other day it just happened to me, you know, and we talk about all that. Why do we talk about this kind of stuff? Why can't we just, okay, God, I know that all things work together for good to them that love God and who are the called according to His purpose. So if you and I love God, and I would venture to say that everybody in here would raise their hand if I asked you, do you love God? Can you and I accept that the circumstances that come our way, if we choose to look at them through the lens of faith and hope and inspiration, they will cause us to become better individuals? I know some of the greatest failures I had in my life actually turned into some of the greatest lessons I ever learned. And if we can go through life with that five-year-old mentality of, I want to learn, I want to grow up, I want to continue to excel. But many of us, we get out of school and we stop learning. And we do the same thing with God. We go through a certain period in life and finally, you know, this faith thing, I tell you what, I got beat up too many times living this faith thing. I think I'm just going to kind of back off a little bit. You know, that's what the devil wants you to say. He won the battle when you and I succumbed to defeat like that. If you and I are going to live and walk in faith, I can tell you there's going to be times where your faith is going to be tested. And let me tell you, there's going to be times that you and I are going to lose some battles and we're going to get beat up pretty bad. But the men and women that choose to persevere in spite are those that ultimately are going to come to the end. And Jesus is going to look at you and I and say, well done, thou good and thou faithful servant. Enter thou into the joy of my life. You kept the fight. You kept hope inside of you. You refused to cower in the face of adverse circumstances and the world coming against you. Somehow you kept picking yourself up and you kept on moving on. We got to be that for the world around us. Well, brother, I got enough I can do with my own life and the life of my family. There's times where our personal lives, we really need to focus in on victories and battles. But I'm here to tell you the grace of God is not only here for you to help you overcome, to help your family overcome, but the grace of God is big enough for you and I to shoulder someone else's burden. Did you know most of the world out there is not exactly looking for advice? Sadly. Did you know most of the people out there that are hurting and that are really discouraged and have difficulties and problems, you know what's one of the number one things that they're after? Two things, rather. Number one is a listening ear. You know what the second thing is? An understanding heart. Aren't those the kind of people that you want to pour your heart out to when you're in dire straits? Usually it is. Are you and I seasoned and matured enough to be that kind of a person to that person that's in need? It's easy to spit out advice. Really easy to give advice, especially when you're not part of the emotional clouds that are surrounding the situation that these people are involved in. But tell you what, try giving a listening ear and having an understanding heart to those people that are in need. You know who you'll become in their life? You'll become a trusted individual. Because a person that has a listening ear and an understanding heart will never stab the person they're in touch with in the back. You and I are better than that. Amen. We've got to stick it out for the long haul with these people that need help. And there's a lot of them that need it. When we quit fighting for what we want in life, the things that we don't want will ultimately overtake us. Okay, a vessel of hope and inspiration. Let's consider Moses in Numbers 11, verse 11. Let's turn there real quick. Numbers 11. Let's go to verse 10. Now, this is Moses kind of in a really bad spot. And they had just, you know, the people were murmuring and complaining. I don't know how Moses did it. The man must have been an amazing person of resilience and authority, and just must have had the back of an ox, so to speak, to be able to carry this people. There's a few times where he kind of got a little frustrated. Verse 10. Moses heard the people weep throughout their families, every man in the door of his tent, and the anger of the Lord was kindled greatly. Now, when Moses hears that, as any leader does and should, he felt the responsibility of those cries. The responsibility of over a million people who were very dissatisfied. Things weren't working out quite the way they planned, did it? The stack of cards that they received was kind of stacked against them. Egypt was a pretty comfortable place, except for there was a lot of stress because of the taskmasters and everything that was over them in their normal work days and all that, but they had everything they needed there to survive. And now you're taking us into a wilderness of uncertainty. And you've brought us here, Moses. Moses, it's your fault. It's your responsibility. We trusted you and we followed. And so Moses, in this moment, in this situation, he's feeling the weight of everything coming down on him. And Moses said unto the Lord, wherefore hast thou afflicted thy servant? And wherefore have I not found favor in thy sight, that thou layest the burden of all this people upon me? Have I conceived all this people? Have I begotten them that thou shouldest say unto me, carry them in thy bosom, as a nursing father beareth the sucking child, unto the land which thou swearest unto their fathers? Whence should I have flesh to give unto all this people? For they weep unto me, saying, give us flesh that we may eat. I am not able to bear all this people alone, because it's too heavy for me. And if thou deal thus with me, kill me, I pray thee, out of hand. If I have found favor in thy sight, and let me not see my wretchedness. Now this is about as low as a leader can ever come when he's leading his people. Moses got there one day. It was a breaking point. Here was this man that up until this point, he was able to shoulder the responsibilities of this people. But he came to a breaking point. 2 Corinthians 1:7 talks about another man in a very similar situation. Let's go to 2 Corinthians. It's start at verse 6 and says, here's Paul writing to the Corinthian church. It says, and whether we be afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effectual in the enduring of the same sufferings which we also suffer, or whether we be comforted, it is for your consolation. It is for your consolation and salvation. And our hope of you is steadfast, knowing that as you are partakers of the suffering, so shall you be also the consolation. Verse 8. For we would not, brethren, have you ignorant of our trouble which came to us in Asia, that we were pressed out of measure, above strength, insomuch that we despaired even of life. There is a place, apparently, that God actually allows His people to come into these zones in life. Well, brother, I'm a person of faith. That would never happen to me. But I'm here to tell you, our faith is going to be tested. You know why it's tested? You know why God tries our faith? Because in these moments of anguish and pain and burdens and the responsibilities coming crashing in on individuals, which if you and I walk with God long enough, whether it be your family, whether it be if you're a pastor, it may be your congregation, if you're a businessman, it may be your business, if you're an employee, it might be your job, whatever it is. These are moments that God allows you and I to come into to test our faith. And it's in these moments the decisions we make, not out of feeling, but out of commitment and duty to the God that has brought us to this place, those decisions we make would decide whether or not these times can be used to our benefit in the future. Because it's in these moments that the seeds of inspiration are sown into our bosom. And when we choose to come through these moments with faith and hope in God, we come out the other side charged with life. But I believe there's many people in this hour, they buckle. I think one of the most dangerous questions we can ask God, and we've talked about this before, is the why question. Why God? Why? What I do to deserve this? Did you know God will actually have mercy on our humanity? But you know one thing that He can't raise up? A quitter. When that switch flips in your brain and you decide to quit, did you know the grace of God is tied? The angels of heaven cease their operation. The angels of heaven work with you on behalf of your decisions and the things that you purpose in your heart to do and become. They know the thoughts and the intents of your heart. And I'm here to tell you tonight that God sent His Son into this world, died for you and I, to cause you and I to become winners in this journey called life. For you and I to not only be winners, but through the battles and through the tests, those tests and those battles that He tries us with, we become vessels of inspiration and hope to people that we influence and interact with in our everyday lives. Don't you want to be that person that when you walk into the hospital room of somebody who's sick in bed, maybe dying, the moment they see your face, something changes in their spirit. I've been around those kind of people in life. And you know what I want to be? I want to be that kind of person. You and I are called of God. Wherever we go, to be that breath of fresh air. Breath of fresh air. You as a daddy, you have the opportunity to be that to your family every night you walk in the door from work. You as a mother, as a wife, you have the opportunity, and both of you have the responsibility, to be that to your husband when he walks in the door in the evening, or vice versa. There's something about you being involved in a situation, in a task, in a crisis situation, that causes things to begin to move in the direction of faith. You and I can change the world around us because of the inspiration that's inside of us. But brother, I'm the only person in my family that's even headed this direction. That's enough. It's enough. One shall put 1,000 to flight, and 2, 10,000. One can do a lot of. Brother Eric talked about that castle the other night. What was it? 28 people defended a castle against an army of, what'd you say, 10,000? 10,000 plus people coming against a castle in England. 28 people defending that castle. But it comes down to where your mindset's at. Called out of comfort into a wilderness of opportunity, a land of expectation. That wilderness of opportunity was designed for one thing. Actually, two things, but it was kind of all-inclusive in the same thing. Get Egypt out of Israel and prepare Israel for Canaan. In order for Israel to conquer Canaan, Egypt had to get out of their system. Sadly, it took a whole generation to get that accomplished. But God got it accomplished. And I believe God wants to accomplish something with you and I in this day that we live in. And it starts with our families. It starts with our communities, our church. Whatever it is that you're involved in. I mentioned the story a few days ago. For those of you that weren't here, I'm going to repeat it. There's a gentleman in Africa that apparently they had a diamond rush, so to speak, compared to our gold rush that we had in America, in the land of Africa many years ago. And there's this farmer heard of the opportunity for diamonds to be found, and he heard the stories and he heard about the wealth and the riches, and so he sold his farm and he struck out looking for diamonds all throughout the land of Africa. And for many years he searched for diamonds, and he, to no avail, came to the end of his life, came to a river, and being unfruitful, he had given away everything, gained nothing. Disappointed, frustrated, he drowned himself in the river. The gentleman that bought the farm from this man, right around the same time, one day went down to the creek that ran through the property, happened to see this sparkling stone on the banks. He picked up the stone, got it inspected. Here was a huge diamond. Needless to say, that happened to be one of the biggest diamond mines of all of Africa, that farm. Now, what kind of, where are your acres of diamonds that you may be sitting on? It makes us, those kind of stories makes us think about who we are and where we're at. If you and I can be present, thinking about where we're at in the moment and what we're doing, we can become stewards of the moment versus dreaming about the future all the time. Tell you what, we'll be successful in everything that we do. It's a mindset. It's a mindset of faith. There's times where it's good to dream. I think it's awesome. We need to have dreams. We need to think about the future, and then we need to write them down and create goals and plans to get there. But that person that purposes to be a steward of the moment. And when you're a steward of the moment, it means you take responsibility for everything that's at hand. And when you and I choose to be responsible people, we become vessels of inspiration to the world around us. You become a valuable resource on the face of this earth. Wasn't it Joshua and Caleb that went over into the land of Canaan and they seen the same giants? Their eyes beheld the same walls, the same armies that the other 10 spies saw as well. How is it that 2 out of the 10, out of 12 people, 2 came back and said, "We can conquer this land." And the other 10 said, "No, there's no way." Do you think they were optimistic? Filled with faith? Filled with expectation? Or do you think their eyes actually saw something different? I think they all saw the same thing. But they all saw a totally different world. And you and I as Christians, we all see the same thing. We all see this, don't we? And we all see the turmoil of the world around us. What are you going to see? What are you going to choose to see for yourself and for your family? God's calling us to be that voice and that light. The darkness is strong, but I can tell you the light within us is greater. I believe the Holy Ghost is looking for people to stay the course. You're called to be an inspiration whether you feel like it or not. You know that? Your feelings are not valid. There was a few times in life where I've come to church feeling as anointed as a toad, and tonight was one of them. Brother Manny can probably attest to it. We've had a pretty interesting week at work. We're down a couple extra people, and so everything is kind of coming together. And it's a lot going on. And sometimes in those kind of weeks, it's kind of hard to gather things together in your spirit. But you know, I walked in those doors tonight. I don't know. There was fresh air waiting inside here. Fresh air. That's what I needed. I needed to see my brother and my sister tonight. That's why I choose to come into the house of God in the middle of the week. Because I need it. I need you. We need each other. Because we fire each other up. And we exhort each other and we ignite each other and we bless each other. It's why the body of Christ around us is so important. Because we as individuals, man, we can get stuck in a rut, can't we? A rut of stinking thinking. My problems, my difficulties, my challenges, my situation. And the angels are behind you all day. You got the Word of God. The life of God is here for you. You need to just get up out of the clouds into the fresh air. Now, it doesn't say that when I walk in here tonight and all the fresh air, that all the problems outside are going to disappear. No. It doesn't work like that. But I tell you what, when you get fresh air and you head back into the problems, you'll be reinvigorated. And guess what? You'll think a whole lot different too. Because when you got the fresh air and the life of the Holy Ghost in your brain and in your spirit, you'll be a whole lot better problem solver. And when you're stuck in the muck, the emotions and the slime and the sludge and the cesspool of this world. That's why I believe Christians need to be involved in every part of society. We need godly people in the government. We need godly people in business. We need godly people everywhere. Because godly people make different decisions than the world does. And God's people have sat on the back burner for way too long. And there's a nation gone to hell, and I thank God. I thank God that there's men and women in Washington, D.C. that care about this nation and care about Judeo-Christian values. That should be important to you and I. So I tell you what, you and I benefit every day the blessings of this land that we have inherited because of decisions that our founding fathers made. Go into D.C. one time and go look at all the monuments and all the scriptures and the references to God that are written in stone. Go walk through the national park sometime. Take your family with you. It's free, by the way. Your tax dollars pay for it. So you don't have to pay. So it's a free trip. You just make the drive to D.C. for 2 hours. But go walk through it sometime. And God is all over the place down there. It's pretty hard to get God out of stone. That's why they say ISIS is going through the Middle East right now. And they're destroying a lot of the ancient ruins that were set up many years ago by Christian people and all that, and they're trying to eradicate every part of the heritage that was in these nations. If they can take away our history, they're going to try to destroy our God. But I can tell you, God's people ain't going down without a fight. Because I believe God's people still have power with God. You're called to offer hope in spite of who you are, in spite. But I ain't this and I ain't that. I don't have enough of money. I don't have enough of education. I don't have a good enough job. I don't know the Word of God good enough. No, God died, sent His Son to die for you. You're called to offer hope to the world around you. But I don't feel like it. I'm stuck in the mud. Maybe you need a brother or sister to come alongside you and give you comfort and hope. That's what we're here for. I'll be the first to say there's times where you and I, we need our brother's hand or someone's hand to help us get up out of stuff. My wife and I balance each other very well. Very seldom are both of us down in the mire. Somehow, miraculously, when one of us is stuck down there, the other just kind of starts working a little harder. And it's just, you know, and it's not in a holier-than-thou manner. It's just, okay, I know my wife's going through a tough time, or she knows I'm going through a difficult, she just, you know, she starts pulling a little harder. It's called teamwork. Sometimes you and I need to gather together as a team and make things happen. Inspiration isn't born in the flowery beds of ease. You know, I heard this song on Christian radio this morning, talking about being an inspirational parent. I wish I could play it for you, but for the sake of time, I didn't download it. I don't even know if it's available on the internet. But it was talking about, the title of the song was something like, I saw the Bible on mommy's rocking chair, something like that. And it's just one of those songs like, oh, God. And anyway, the song went on to say so much that, you know, I saw David slay Goliath, you know, through my mother's stories on her rocking chair, and how that child seen the stories of the Bible unfold. And I got to thinking about that, and I was like, you talk about the power of a good mother. Listen, folks. You mothers, you have no idea the inspiration that you can be to the generation behind you. And I'm here to say, my hat's off to you. And I'm here to say, if you're not a mother or if you're expecting to be a mother in the future, Daddy's going to be busy a lot of the time. God created him to, you know, kill the deer and drag it home. But you mothers, you have a calling that a daddy most certainly can't do. And that is to place into that child's mind and in their hearts and in their spirits who God is. And teach them about God through the stories of the Bible. And you're going to brainwash the child. It's either you or the world. I mean, I thank God that I had a mother that took the time to read Bible stories to me when I was a youngster. Those things have never left me. David and Goliath was just a part of my grown-up years. And this is what you can do as a mother. I knew what Moses did. He led the children of Israel through the Red Sea. And I remember the Bible storybook that we used to read. It was like illustrated pictures and all that. And I don't know, it probably wasn't scripturally correct, but, you know, this is this path with walls of water, like walls on either side of the building. On either side, you know, the children throwing rocks up against it and all that stuff as they're going through the sea. But it might have not been totally theologically correct, but I tell you what, it branded something in my memory. And those stories of the Bible and along with teaching us manners and how to live godly. These are things that godly nations don't do. And this is something you and I, it's our responsibility. Because we got to make sure this next generation survives, don't we? They need God.
And it's harder to live out there for God than it ever was probably. Because these young people, they have a fight on their hands. But we can be strong for them.
Yeah. 2 Timothy 2:15 says, "Study to shew thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth." There's got to be water in that well. Isaiah 12, verse 2, and we've read this scripture many times, says, "Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid." That's a decision based not on five senses. That's a decision based upon your belief in God and who He is and what He said He will do for your life. That garrison of peace that Brother Eric was talking about, that's a person that's trusting and they're not going to be afraid. "Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. For the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. And He also is become my salvation. Therefore, with joy shall you draw water out of the wells of salvation." Wells of inspiration. You and I are called to be nothing less to this generation. God expects it out of us. He requires it out of us. It's our responsibility. And I'm here to tell you that we can do it. Amen. Okay, I'm going to close down with that. Heavenly Father, I thank You tonight for Your precious Word. And I'm asking that You would continue to guide us as we come in and through the days ahead. That You would teach us, that You would lead us according to Your mercy. Thank You, God, for upholding us by the right hand of Your salvation and causing us to walk in places that many have been fearful of walking into. But Heavenly Father, because of Your grace in our lives, we can make those decisions, we can walk those paths, and Lord, we know that You'll help us every step of the way. Thank You so much for being God to Your people in the midst of this generation that we live in, and we thank You for it in Jesus' name. Is there anybody in here needs prayer for anything tonight?